Headphone listening today is a big part of music consumption. That should make us discuss again if neutral monitoring is different today than it was maybe 10 or 20 years ago. So I'll be discussing that today from both an ideal in-room angle where we're listening to monitors in a room and from an ideal headphone angle where we are improving the performance of normal headphones. Let's first consider natural listening. So if we're listening to, for instance, a violin, we'll be hearing the direct sound with both ears. Also, if we're listening in a room, of course, we'll be hearing reflections coming from the room. The question then is, how much of those reflections would we consider neutral? And how would we go about it when we're listening, for instance, to headphones, where we, of course, don't have that extra contribution from a reproduction room, if we are doing the reproduction of the violin. So in that way, a mono source, a natural mono source in a room becomes immersive, and if we're reproducing it in a lively listening room, it becomes immersive also. But that then raises the next 80-year-old dilemma. We call it the inception dilemma. It's a question of not a dream in a dream, but a room in a room. And that second room, for that to be neutral, what do we demand of it? It's quite important because we rely on that reproduction room also to give us the precision of the tools that we're using. For instance, just setting the level or doing power panning, we really rely on that reproduction principle. But on the other hand, we don't want the reproduction room to kill the recording hall, so to speak. If we have made a beautiful recording, we don't want to destroy it with the monitoring room we're listening in. So let's first consider imaging during reproduction. We have to admit that the most used tool, our mixing tool, level panning, is not natural. You never have the same source originating from two different locations at the same time or at full correlation. It simply cannot happen in nature. So it's a construct, but it's a very efficient construct, and we can reliably then at least pan on the 60-degree stereo listening angle, and most people can appreciate that kind of panning without it actually being natural. But we rely on those crossfeeds that also happen in nature, like we listened to the violin before. We are listening to loudspeakers in the same way. But we should be aware that we are creating a lot of coloration at the center, which is where we are panning our most important sources, like a vocal in a music mix, or many of the most important instruments will be at the center of the image, which is also where we have the most coloration. So that then means that, especially at the center, all the sources at the center, will have a big difference from what we're hearing using normal headphones and using a neutral in-room monitoring system. There's also another aspect where we want neutrality. We want neutrality in a way that we are not destroying, for instance, a wonderful recording, in this case of a good concert hall. So what you call envelopment or listener envelopment can be latent in the source. And if you have a reproduction room that sort of overpowers the recording room, then you're sort of, or you're destroying envelopment, or you're at least manipulating envelopment, and you cannot be sure what is neutral or what is in the source anymore. The same is true in immersive recordings. Some of the finest immersive recordings, we have microphones positioned at a distance so you get decorrelation at low frequency. This is Morten Lindberg's, one of his wonderful recordings, where he's using a good microphone distance to be sure that he can capture envelopment in the source. And we don't want to squelch that when we're monitoring. So there are many aspects to this. There's the level, there's the panning or imaging, and then there's the envelopment. And they're all, we want them all to be neutral the best we can. So with listeners now using headphones predominantly, that reproduction room is no longer a given thing. So these important issues we talked about are missing in normal headphone reproduction. But all the important aspects that we want to judge of a mix, we have to take care of those. Those need to be part of our judgment. They need to be part of neutral reproduction. And these are summarized here: mixing levels, imaging, sound color, and listener envelopment. Those four we need to take care of precisely. Now let's first consider those elements from an ideal in-room perspective, which means monitoring with loudspeakers in a room. We have used this ultra near field principle that has really been idealized by monitors we call the ones, the range of Genelec monitors, point source monitors, where you can be listening at a very close distance, thereby taking the room out of the equation as much as you want. So if you're in a bad reproduction location, you can just go close to your monitors, and it's like having ideal headphones, because you can use your crossfeeds, you can even use some minor movements of your head, and you get everything rendered really precisely, regardless of the listening room you're in. So we can come at neutral monitoring from two sides. We can either come at it from the in-room side or from the headphone side. In this case, I'm showing you the ideal in-room setup for neutral monitoring with those quantities preserved. In this case, we're using what we call an ultra near field setup. We're using Genelec 83 series, ideally ones, which is 83, 31, 41, 51 or 61. One of those, one of those models. And then we're using them at very close range, as you can see here on the drawing. And we're listening at only 50 centimeters distance, which is the same as 1.5 feet or something like that. So by doing that, you're taking the room out of the equation, the reproduction room. You don't hear it, but you're still getting the benefit of the GLM reference listening, because with GLM 4.1 and up, you can really get the most out of ultra near field setup like this one. So this is one ideal way of monitoring without getting the reproduction room to disturb you too much. And also, of course, if you happen to be in a place where the room is terrible, then you can largely take it out of the picture by moving very close to your loudspeaker setup. So we might ask ourselves, how does this sound on headphones? And from what I've been talking about, I'm sure you can appreciate that I would say that the best way to find out is not to use a traditional pair. Because if you're using a traditional pair of headphones, you're avoiding some of the principles. The main goals of mixing, many of our main techniques, simply don't work reliably when you're using headphones. So even if you're passing around the same pair, then what I'm hearing will be different from what you're hearing. You have to put in more effort to be able to discuss how it sounds on headphones. And the missing link here is actually Aural ID. This is the first time that you will be able to enter the precision into the picture that we are used to in professional listening. That is because you're then entering a lot of personal features into listening again. And then if I'm passing around the same set of headphones, then the only thing is required is that when I'm listening to those headphones, I'll be using my profile. When you're listening to the same set of headphones, you're listening to your profile. And then we can discuss how it sounds relevantly. Very few professionals have actually taken the time to investigate this. What does personally neutral mean in headphones? Different people have different preferences for headphone types, but they probably don't realize that the reason why is that the different headphone types also have different pronunciations of different frequencies, and then they happen to be frequencies that are agreeable to you or that sound familiar to you. But to get all that, you could say, variation and lack of predictability out of the picture, you need to personalize the system. This is, we can talk about what is a normal human, and we are talking about that in all different areas. For instance, we're talking about it in architecture or in furniture, and this is the old Corbusier drawing of Le Modulor, the modular man. And we can use it in legislation, we can use it in medicine. I'm part of a European standardization group, or hazard prevention group for the prevention of hearing loss. And then it's very useful, of course, to talk about standard ears and standard humans and sound exposure, things like that. From a professional perspective, what we would be more interested in would be the personal approach. In that case, it would be the outer ear. It would be also, of course, relaying neural impulses to the brain, but also being aware that the brain actually sends a lot of impulses back to the ear. So the way we are reacting to sound is very personal, both on, you could say, on the physiological side, but also regarding the experience we've had in our life so far. So that means that with Aural ID, you get a very, very reliable relative calibration of all the different angles that you're hearing. But some of the variables you're not really taking care of. You need to enter a little bit more information to get the absolute calibration right as well. And in that case, it's very useful, again, to come back to the in-room listening and to the reference that you're used to. This takes care of variation between listeners. It takes care of also headphone-related variations. So for instance, I might have a pair of headphones of a certain type, and you might have one of the same type, but they might be manufactured in different years. It might be different factories. It might be slightly different models. Impedance also plays a role, actually. So if you have a pair of headphones that is, for instance, 250 ohms, and you have the same type at 55 ohms, their frequency response is not the same. Finally, there's some interaction between the listener and the headphones. So again, this final subjective calibration is necessary to get to a precision that we normally are used to in pro audio. So here's the ultra near field setup I'm using when I'm calibrating my Aural ID. In this case, you can see this is a pair of 8341s. They are at 50 centimeters listening distance at a 30 degree listening angle, like you saw in the diagram. They are calibrated by GLM 4.1 using extended phase linearity. Then I also control the listening level. It's very difficult to control listening level in headphones, but what you have to have the same subjective loudness when you're listening to headphones as in-room. So you can calibrate your in-room system using an SPL meter. I'm using 76 dB SPL, slow A-weighted at the listening position. And then I calibrate my in-room system once and for all, then play the same stereo tracks to the in-room system and to the headphones, making sure that loudness is always equal. So when I'm doing adjustments to the headphones, I constantly also need to adjust their level. I keep the level of the in-room system constant throughout the calibration process. So when I'm listening to headphones, I obviously put them on and mute the in-room system. So I'm listening like this. Then I'm listening to the same tracks using the in-room system. And once you go through the calibration process step by step and taking out that last bit of variation that we talked about, then you end up with a result almost as good as your in-room system. Of course, there will always be areas where you cannot mimic them precisely. The extended frequency range, the haptic sensation from the 41s, you are using slight movements as that's part of your listening, and that's not precisely emulated in the headphones. But besides from that, you can get all the other variables taken care of this way. So this is a way of achieving your final calibration using an excellent pair of in-room system and your favorite headphones. So that concludes the ultra near field setup calibration process. Of course, you can also use another excellent near field monitoring system. It doesn't need to be a Genelec system, but if you're using, for instance, a GLM calibrated system and ideally a one system like I'm doing here, then you're really taking the room out of the picture and you're doing this with the, I would say, the ultimate precision. In case you don't have access to such a system yourself, you can also visit a Genelec Experience Center or maybe a friend who has access to the system. I think you need to use it maybe for a couple of hours. I think I probably, it took me 3 or 4 hours coming back and forth a couple of times. But of course, by only having it for 10 minutes, you still get a much better result than not doing it at all. So it's a question of the more time you put into it, the better your end result will be. So the outcome of all this is first and foremost that you get to know yourself as a listener, as a headphone listener, and of course that you refine and verify a new tool so you really can trust it for monitoring in the future. So in conclusion, Aural ID is based on what you can call true sonic reference requirements. So it means that you will get the same type of precision that you're used to from in-room monitoring by going through the Aural ID process, including the subjective calibration at the end. So by that, you'll both get to know yourself as an headphone listener, but also getting, of course, access to a valuable tool that you can use when you don't have access to your excellent in-room system. I can only speak for myself, but it's quite gratifying that you can tap into those qualities also when you're on the road, for instance. So with that, I will welcome you hopefully to a more predictable future of headphone monitoring.